So the whole world will know that we're not alone. It's waiting for you. Knocking at your door. Every moment of truth when your heart hits the floor. And I'll be my brother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone.
This church, it's amazing to see how on fire this church is. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the times that you give us. I thank you for the times you give Pastor Rob and everybody in this church. In your name we pray, amen.
Next time I go to the doctor's office and they ask what my exercise plan is, I'm going to tell them church. And they should send all their patients. Hi folks, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Tara. I tend to get a little nervous up here. A lot of you have heard about that already. Get the opportunity to talk to you about tithes and offerings. People always get nervous about that, or at least I do. I've been to churches where pastors talk about money. Till recently. Actually, a couple weeks ago, to be quite honest. I was at a Forge meeting one night. And I'm sorry, Ricky, I got 30 under the bus, bud. Mr. Ricky back there is one of our youth group helpers. He's here every Friday night. Volunteers his time. He walks to get here. And he came to me a couple weeks ago, and he says, I don't know what it is about this place, but every time I come here, I just feel good. It's your people or the place, I don't know. And Ricky probably remembers what I said to him. It was something along the lines of, well, it's because you're giving. You're giving of yourself and you enjoy that. It makes you feel good. It really does. About 5 or 6 days later, I'm sitting in my kitchen. My daughter, Callie, she's going to get mad because I'm throwing her under the bus, too. And she says, I can't wait until Christmas. Which, by the way, is 110 days away. Callie has the countdown in her head. Surprisingly, though, the reason she loves Christmas is because she likes to give. Imagine that. For a teenager, pretty darn impressive. So that's the thing about giving. When you give, it makes you feel good. And that's why I think God really, really wants us all to give all the time. I can stand up here and I can read you Bible verses, but I don't think I need to. I see most of you are shaking your head yes, so y'all get it. I am going to read you one, though, if my hands will stop shaking long enough to pull it out. It says, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. I truly believe that. You know, if you're down and out, you're having a bad day, the best thing to do is throw the mic away because it doesn't work. And then the next thing you should do, try giving, whether it's a smile or a dollar or a kind hand to help somebody in need. That's why I think it's important to you. To your friends, your neighbors, and even your church. That's what I'm going to ask you guys to do today. I'm not sure what's going on with the tech back there. We always have trouble with that. Maybe some
Rob touched it. Yeah,
and as you guys consider how you want to give, whether it's your time or your heart or your dollars, I'm just going to ask God that He bless these offerings as they're given, whatever shape or form they're given, and that He works through us to use them as He sees fit. That's all I have for you guys today.
Amen.
Your palms are sweaty. You have butterflies in your stomach. Let's face it, you're scared. You've rehearsed this conversation in your head 1,000 times. Immediately, your mind starts racing to the worst-case scenario. What if she says no or laughs at me? What if she thinks I'm a weirdo that lives in a van? What if she has ties to the Russian mafia and I end up sleeping with the fishes? Thankfully, you snap out of it. There's no way that'll ever happen. After all, she seems like a friendly person, always nice to you at work. Unlike Kathy. What's Kathy's problem anyway? Wait, you're getting off topic. Stop stalling and be a man. You can do this. Just ask. You pick up the phone. Your mind is made up. You're gonna do it. After you check Facebook. 20 minutes later, you work up the courage again and you make the call. It rings. You want to hang up, but it's too late. She answers.
Hello?
Your mind goes blank. You didn't think it through this far.
Hey, I'm next to you. I sit next to you at work. It's Tim.
What are you saying?
Oh, hey, Tim. What's up? Something go wrong with the Jenkins?
Jenkins, no.
Why are you laughing?
Actually, I have a question I've been meaning to ask you for a while. Where do you get your teeth cleaned?
The dentist. Why?
Yes, Tim, why? Why would you ask that stupid question?
No reason. So, what are you doing this weekend?
No plans. How about you?
Here's your chance. Your heart starts pounding and your voice quivers as you nervously blurt out,
"Do you want to go with me to church?"
Inviting someone to church doesn't have to be like an awkward first date. Just ask.
Sunday, so for you to take time out of this weekend and be here, I'm especially grateful. Now, if you've not been in a denominational church, you might not even know there's such a thing as Labor Sunday. We all know there's Labor Weekend, Labor Day Weekend, but Labor Sunday is the Sunday of Labor Day Weekend, and it's a day to lift up workers. It's a day to sort of celebrate their contributions, their support. It's a day that we lift up their struggles. It's a day that we commit ourselves to sort of improving the job so that all these workers, these people that are the backbone of the United States, have benefits, have work hours, that their wages are fair. It's a day that we just celebrate and pray for them, allow them to be self-sufficient and to live the lives that God intended them to live. But if you didn't know it was Labor Sunday, I bet you did know it was Labor Day weekend, didn't you? And for many of you, Labor Day weekend, it just simply means that you get a day off on Monday. It means that it's a long holiday weekend for you. It means that you get the barbecue, and maybe for some of you it means the end of summer and the beginning of fall. And all these reasons are the fact that I love the fact that you're all here today, because you can be anywhere on Labor Day weekend, and yet you decided to be with us. So I truly appreciate it. Labor Day weekend is actually one of the least attended church days in the United States, because people take the time off and they go on vacation, they go away, things like that. So the fact that you decided to join us this morning, I don't want to take that for granted. I want you to know how much I really appreciate that. But I also want you to know, if you're wondering what Labor Day is actually all about, I'm going to tell you about that. And so we might not learn a lot about the Bible, we might not learn about Jesus, but we're going to know what Labor Day is all about, okay? Labor Day weekend was set aside to dedicate all the workers, all the efforts of the workers, both present and past, that have made the United States who they are. The ones that have helped provide the social, the economical, the political background of our country. Labor Day was actually born out of a movement back in the late 19th century. It was a labor movement, and there was a lot of violence over what was going on at the time, and workers were beginning to search for better working conditions, fairer pay. They were trying to get union representation. I mean, if we watch the news, it almost as if it could happen today, right? Anyway, Labor Day was actually signed into law by a couple of states back in 1887. Colorado, Massachusetts, New Jersey, New York, and Oregon all signed it into law in 1887. And then over the course of the next couple of years, a lot of other states did as well. 7 years later, Congress voted the first Monday in September as Labor Day. So, now that you know the true meaning of Labor Day and Labor Sunday, I want to take a moment, and you have these in your bulletins, if you have a bulletin, the words will be up on the screen, and I just want to take a time as we pray together, and you can pray along with me if you'd like, pray for the workers of the United States, of the world, pray for the fact that we're going to stand in solidarity with them, with our neighbors, and with our workforce this Labor Day weekend. So if you will, bow your heads and let's pray. Loving, working God, on this Sunday we ask your special blessing on all people who labor, either for pay or for volunteers or in jobs or at school or in church or in the workplace or at home, in the U.S. and around the world. We especially pray your blessings on workers who do not have jobs, for those whose inadequate pay doesn't even allow them to live the full life you intended for each of us to live, And Creator God, we hope, ask that you build this new world in which the midst of the old world that we live in today, a world where all workers are valued, a world where those who clean houses are also able to buy houses to live in, a world where those who grow food can also afford to eat their fill, a world where those who serve and care for others are them themselves also serve and care for. We pray for the coming of a world where all your workers everywhere share in the abundance that you have given each of us. We ask these things knowing that you give us the courage and the strength to live out our faith in the workplace and in the marketplace, as well as in the sanctuary. And we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now that we know about Labor Day, it's not about a long weekend or a family picnic or even the unofficial end of summer, but to celebrate and acknowledge the workers around the world. But if you're in school, especially if you're in the Indian River School District, Labor Day is always going to be your last weekend that you celebrate before you have to go back to the bondage of school. So I remember when I was a child, my mom would always say and tell her friends towards the end of summer vacation, she says, at the end of Labor Day, on that first day of school, she goes, I'm going to do cartwheels in front of the bus. Now, I didn't know what she meant by that until I had four kids, and it got to be the end of summer vacation and the end of my wits. And if I could have done a cartwheel a couple years ago, I'd have probably done the same thing. But here's what I want to do. I believe in the power of prayer. I truly do. So I'm going to ask that we have all our children come up here and gather at the altar. And I want to pray over our children. And I know if you're a parent and you want to come up here with us, feel free to do so. But the words are going to be up here, and I would ask that you pray with me. Our kids in today's school wasn't like when we were growing up. You know, we had our problems, we had a lot of things. Come on, Cal. But it's not like it is today. Come on, Cal.
Cal, you're a kid.
I don't go to school, though. But you are schooled. So come on.
Lissy?
No.
Yeah, come on.
No.
You told Gary you got to come up here.
I never said that.
I think she can handle it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the gift of our children. Father, we just pray that you watch over each of them as they go back to school and protect them from the negative influences, protect them from the evil and the dangers that are becoming more and more a part of their daily lives. Father, we ask that you help them be a light to others. Help them by the power of your Holy Spirit to show love, care for, and respect for their friends, their classmates, and their teachers, even if their teacher happens to be their mom. Father, please protect them from bullies, but if they have to face one, we ask that you give them the courage and the strength to stand up for themselves and for others. And Father, help them to remember when they're scared or afraid, you are there with them. As much as we love our children, you love them even more. Father, we thank you for all of this in the precious name of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. It is hard to believe that summer vacation is just about over. And I'm still getting used to this new setup, so bear with me just a little bit. But this is Sunday morning. I know this takes a little bit of time, but I promise we'll get out of here on time. No matter what we do, we always try to be out of here just about 11:30. But since it's Sunday morning, and this is a church, we ought to do some churchy stuff, don't you think? I'm going to start out this morning, and I want to ask you a question. And it's a fairly simple question, but the question is, have you ever lost anything? I'm hoping a lot of you are like me, that you lose things all the time. Not because I want anything bad from you, but because you know that saying, misery loves company? I mean... If I had all the time back, and I said, so if I had all the time back that I spent looking for things, I'd only be 15 years old. I mean, I lose stuff all the time. I don't know, for those of you that work with me or know me, most of the time I am looking for something that I just had in my hand. I'm the only person I know that can sit at my desk, never get up, be working on something, and turn around and lose something that I just had. I never got up. I don't know how I do it, but I do. And I'll spend the next half hour looking for something that has to be on the desk because I've never moved. The other day we were in the front there in the lobby. And I never got off the couch. It was, and I couldn't, it took us a half, in fact, Lissy had to find it for me. And he got down under the couch. And how did that happen? I just don't have a clue. But he never lost anything really important. I'm not talking about a pen or maybe a cell phone, but I have to admit that I've been in a state of panic before when I bought the cell phone. But I mean something really, really important, like a kid. You ever lost a kid and never knew what your child was? I mean, that can set you out in fear. I remember one time when my son Alec was just in first grade, and he would ride the bus to school and then he'd ride it home. And one afternoon, it started getting really late, and we noticed that Alec wasn't home from school yet. And Dan and I are starting to get, and my wife, you guys know if you didn't know that, though, we started getting really worried to where Alec was. I mean, it was later than the bus had ever been. We didn't see him. We didn't know where he was at, so we called the school. Now, when we called the school told us that everything went as normal as far as they were concerned, and things are a lot different today. They keep a lot more control on the kids, but 20 years ago they didn't. As far as they knew, he'd gotten on the bus and everything was okay. And the bus driver had never called and said there was a problem. So by now, we're starting to get really, really scared. Now, we started thinking, you know, questions that most of you would probably think, did he miss the bus and start walking home? Because even at 6 years old in first grade, he was an independent little thing. And did somebody take him out in front of the school? You know, you heard stories about that. But we're starting to get really scared. So we called the bus driver. The bus driver says, you know, he never saw how to get on the bus, and he didn't know where he was. So now it's an hour past the time he's supposed to be home, and we're starting to panic. We call back to school, they're starting to panic. Everybody's starting to panic, which isn't helping us. So I'm driving around, and back in the 90s, I don't even remember, I'm calling all his friends. Cell phones were about the size of an arm, and they were just about as heavy. I have to tell you, when I get scared, you know, sometimes I'm like a snake. I just want to strike out. And I'm calling the school every 5 minutes, and that's probably not helping the situation, but I don't care because my focus, my sole focus is on finding my son. And I'm getting more and more worried all the time because I love my son, and he's lost, and I want to find out where he's at. I want to know that he's safe. After about an hour after that, so it's 2 hours after Alex should have been home, we're getting frantic. You know, the bus driver doesn't know where he's at. We don't know where he's at. I've driven to him. I'm calling his friend's house. I've got all of them worried. Everybody's worried out. You know, and we just don't know what to do. Well, I guess Alec had got on the bus without the bus driver noticing it and went into the back of the bus and fell asleep. And the bus driver, you know, when he got home, I guess he didn't just go and clean out his bus. He went home and probably ate some dinner and probably watched a little TV, but then he goes outside to wash his bus down. And I guess the hose spraying against the metal bus and windows woke my son up. So he's like, I can see this picture, he's like creeping up. He don't know where he's at. He's lost, he's scared, and he looks up, and all he sees is this guy with a water hose in his hand spraying water at him. Now I'm thinking, as their eyes met, both of them probably let out a scream. My son's scared, and this guy's scared because he knows he's got to call everybody and tell them that he missed my son on the bus. But I didn't care. I didn't care where Alec was found. I didn't care how he was found. I was just glad he was found and that he was safe. You know, I don't know if you've ever lost anything before, but when you're lost, when you've lost something really important, your sole focus is on that lost thing. It is not on the things that are found, dark. You know, one of the things I didn't do was sit around and think to myself, well, I got three other kids, Chelsea, Alec, Taylor, and Kayla, and they're looking pretty good today. They're all playing pretty well together. I'm glad I know where three out of four of my kids are. I'm good. I got three. If I lose one, I just make another one. It never occurred to me to keep my eyes on my kids that were found. I was solely focused on my lost son because I loved him and I wanted him to be safe. Did you know that our Heavenly Father feels the same way about his children? He loves them And he doesn't want anything bad to happen to us because we're lost. And if we look at the scriptures this morning, we're going to see in these ancient documents that have been preserved for thousands of years that Jesus is always, 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 100% of the time, he's more concerned with those that are lost than those that are found. Jesus is always more concerned about those that are disconnected from him than those that are connected from him. He's always more concerned about the outsiders than he is the insiders. God the Son, like God the Father, is passionate, about finding the lost. And you know, the truth is, church for church people, you just do the things that they like, and they'll come. And then you have your teachers, and then you have your mentors, and then you have your study call or your Sunday school teachers and all that. But if we do that, the kingdom of God never gets built, does it? All we're doing is just transferring God's people from one church to another church. We're just transferring the kingdom of God from one place to another place, but we're never, ever really building the kingdom of God. Oh. See, that's what we want here at the Odyssey Church. We want what God wants. We want to seek and save the lost. We want to help people find and follow Jesus. We want to help people and lead them into a deeper relationship with him. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to create environments, we're trying to create a culture in which lost people will feel comfortable. Because we know that if we can make enough difference in somebody's lives, that we'll make enough difference in their families. And if we make enough difference in enough families, we'll make a difference in our community. We strive to create an environment. We strive to create a culture where we can make a difference in the lives of people. But the problem is, when you make church about unchurched people, some of the church people stop coming. But it's a two-sided coin, because when you make church about church people, the unchurched people quit coming. And we're more concerned about the unchurched than we are the church. We need church people. We need mature Christians to help mentor and teach. But if our heart is like God's heart, if we're passionate about what God's passionate about, we have to be passionate about the lost. Our main concern as a church must always be with those who are outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ. Our main concern must always be about seeking and saving the people that the scriptures, the Bible, calls those who are lost. Now when the Bible talks about being lost, it's not talking about being lost spatially. I mean, God's not up in heaven going, "Where's Rob? He was here just a few minutes ago. Is he hiding from me?" God's not talking about being lost spatially. He's talking about being lost relationship. So my desire, the people at this church, the lead team, our desire is that we can be a church, we can create a culture where people will show up who maybe don't believe like we believe, who maybe don't, they come in and they say, "You know, I don't know if I really get what they're saying, but that church, they really made me feel welcome. They loved on me, even though most of them knew what I'm doing." We want to create an experience and a culture where people would come in, and they may not believe as we believe, but they'll come and say, "You know, I felt so much love there. I think maybe there's something there for me. I think maybe I'll come back next week." Jesus' attention was focused on the outsiders and not on the insiders. Jesus was always, 100% of the time, focused on the people who were lost. And to illustrate his point, he would tell these stories to help people remember what he was talking about and to help remember his point. I mean, he tells a story about a lost coin. He told about this lady who had lost one of her 10 coins, and she's searching the house, and she's just like sweeping every corner of the house, and she can't find her coin. And I heard this week. I didn't have time to do the research to see if it was true, but the 10 coins was like a something that they would put into a band and the lady would wear around her head. It would be the dowry of what the husband would get if he married her. So to go out in public with only 9 coins or 8 coins was a terrible embarrassment. She would never dream about that. So she's got to find this coin. And when she finds the coin, she talks about how she rejoiced, and she would call her friends and say, "Rejoice with me, because I have found my lost coin." Now, I don't know if any of you lost things and you called your friends, and your cell phone in today's world is probably the best example. You like call your friends and say, "Call my phone so I can find it." And then when you find it, you call everybody and say, "Hey, I found my phone." Jesus told stories about lost people all the time. He told a story about a lost son. And this son wasn't lost spatially. He was lost relationally. He asked his dad for his inheritance before his dad was dead. And those times, that was the same thing as saying, "Dad, I wish you were dead." And his dad, in his grace and his mercy, he gives him his inheritance, and the boy just goes off into the world, and he spends the money foolishly, and he does things that no person should do. And because he spent his money so foolishly, he runs out of it. It's gone. He becomes broken. He becomes hungry. And he sort of wanders home with his tail between his legs, thinking that his dad's going to punish him and chastise him. His dad doesn't do that. His dad looks in the distance and sees his lost child coming home. And his dad runs to him. And in the Greek, he begins to kiss him in the neck. And what it means was he kissed him and kissed him and kissed him and kept on kissing him. And his dad doesn't punish him. And he doesn't chastise him. But he dresses him in the most expensive clothes. He gives him a banquet with the most expensive food. He throws him a party and rejoices because his son who was lost is now found. You know, that's just a perfect picture of God, how he rejoices when somebody who is out of relationship with him gets back in relationship with him. He doesn't care what you've done. He don't care how bad you've been. He already knows. He is just rejoicing that you repented, that you turned around, and that you came back to him. So Jesus wanted to make it perfectly clear to the people he's talking to. He wanted to make it perfectly clear to the people like us that he was more concerned with people outside the church than he was with people inside the church. Now, it doesn't mean that he doesn't love us, of those of us that are in the church. We should gather together, and God loves us with an everlasting love. But his concern, his passion, is with those who are lost, those who are not in a relationship with him. You know, if you remember some of the things we talked about, or maybe what you learned in Bible school, or you know, something you learned as a kid that counts, we've talked about it before. If you know the type of people that Jesus hung around with, Jesus usually hung around with people who were sinners. And some of them were great big sinners. You know, the Bible says that there were sinners and then there were sinners. And the sinners were the prostitutes and the tax collectors and the drunkards. And that is the people that Jesus hung around with. He hung around with the outsiders. He hung around with the lost. And most of the time, and here's the amazing thing, most of the time when he hung around the church people, he was telling them how wrong they were doing church. That they were excluding his people, not including his people. Most of the people at that time, you know, unless you cleaned up your act and you started looking like them and acting like them, they weren't going to have you come into their church. And the unfortunate thing is, I've been in churches almost just like that. But that's not God's heart. God's heart's not for the insiders. It's not for the church. It's for the unchurched, for the outside, for those who are outside of relationship with him. So the story we're going to look at this morning is found in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 18. It's the Gospel of Matthew chapter 18. We're only going to be looking at 5 verses, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. And it's a story of a lost sheep. Jesus would tell parables. Jesus would tell these stories. And a parable is a story that Jesus made up to make a point so you would remember the story. So there's a couple things you need to know about this parable as we get started. Right, first of all, throughout the scriptures, God always refers to himself, or not always, but often refers to himself as a shepherd. I mean, Jesus even said in the Gospel of John, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd sacrifices his life for his sheep." And we know that's exactly what Jesus did. He sacrificed himself for us who are his sheep. Because throughout the scriptures, and the second thing I want you to know, is that we are often referred referred to as sheep. So you have the shepherd who overlooks the sheep. And the great shepherd sacrificed his life for the sheep. Jesus died on the cross for the lost. Jesus died on the cross for us. So in this parable, keep in mind that God's the shepherd and we're the sheep. And finally, what you'll notice, if you have a newer version of the Bible, like we use here, we normally preach out of the New Living Translation, and that's because it's an easy translation to read, and it's very accurate in the translation. You will notice that there's no verse 11. That's because the oldest manuscripts don't have verse 11 in them. Now this morning, as I speak, I'm going to use verse 11, and the reason I'm going to use verse 11 is the Gospel of Luke gives this same story, and Luke, who was a doctor who did careful research, includes the same words that some translations use in verse 11. So we know Jesus made this statement, so we're going to include it in our teaching this morning. Now, if you don't have a Bible, they're right there by the front door, please grab one. On your way out. I mean, they're free. Or if you have a Bible and you like the translation we speak out of, please grab one on your way out. They're free. They're our gift to you because we know that one book can transform your life. A lot of books can inform, but that's the only one that can transform. And if you take that book, you bring it back next week, and you're allowed to write it. You're allowed to write your own notes so that you can help remember the message. So, anyway, this morning, I'm going to start in verse 10. And we're going to include verse 11 because some translations do include it, and we know it's a statement that Jesus said. He says, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. For the Son of Man has come to save that which is lost." So, the first thing I want you to see this morning, as he talks about it, he says, you know, these little ones. I want you to know that no matter how insignificant you feel, how the world feels about it, how small you may feel, there is nobody that's outside of God's love. There is nobody that Jesus didn't come to save. He said, "I came to save all that are lost." Every one of you, no matter what you've done, no matter where you are, no matter what your position is in the world, Jesus came to save you. You're not too small, you're not too insignificant to be noticed by the angels in heaven themselves, by God the Father himself, or Jesus himself. Everybody is who Jesus died for on the cross. And then Jesus makes these couple of statements, and I think he does so to catch our attention, because the answers are so obvious. He says, "What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go look for the one that wandered away? If one of God's children was lost and can't be found, won't he leave the other 3 to go find the one that was lost?" God seeks everyone. And I think Jesus asked these questions so that he would catch people's attention, because the people he was speaking to at the time would know exactly what he was talking about. It was the shepherd's job to keep a watch over all the sheep. Of course he's going to go look for the lost sheep, because that's his livelihood. That's what he gets paid to do. And it's not like we think about it. He didn't just leave 99 sheep on a hill to sort of fend for themselves. At that time, there'd be many people that were helping him, but the shepherd himself is the one that went out and sort of looked for the sheep. So, he goes on and he begins to get to the point of his parable. Jesus tells us what happened when this man finds his sheep. And he said, if the shepherd, if he finds it, truly I tell you, he is happier about the one sheep than about the 99 that did not wander off. When I found my son, I was delighted. I was excited. That didn't mean I didn't love my kids that were still at home. But they were lost. I knew where they were. When I found Allie, I was rejoicing. I was happier that I found him than about the 3 sitting home. Not because I didn't love them just as much, but they were lost. So Jesus gets to the point. He makes this point. Here's the big idea of what Jesus wants us to know. He says, in the same way, isn't it not my Heavenly Father's will that even one of these little ones should perish? don't want any of us to perish. They don't want any of us to be in danger because we're lost. And we see that God's attention isn't focused on those who are found. His attention is focused on those who are lost. His focus isn't on the sheep that aren't in danger. This man, God's attention soared as on those who are lost. Jesus has shown us how much God loves us, how much he's hoping that every one of us will come to that, hoping that every one of us will be found so nothing bad happens to us, particularly at the end of our life where he says, we should perish. God says, I want you to be found. I don't want you to perish. I don't want you to perish if you aren't found. And again, God's not talking about being lost spatially. He's talking about being lost relationally. People who are disconnected from God are what the scriptures call lost. And the interest of Jesus, what Jesus' interest is the same thing that God's interested in. And that's lost. Those that are disconnected, those who are outside of you. We all know this, isn't it? When someone or something that's lost and we love it, our focus, our attention, our interest on what is lost and not what's found. When a child of God is lost, God doesn't find a lot of comfort in the found things. You know what I think gets God excited? I don't think, and please don't misinterpret this, I don't think it's a bunch of found people getting together singing songs on Sunday morning. I think God enjoys that, and I know we should do that because the Bible tells us we shouldn't go out and not attend, and tells us in the book of Hebrews that we should gather with fellow-like people. We encourage each other. We build each other up. We get ourselves so that we can go out together and do what God wants us to do. And I think God loves that. But I think what he really gets excited about, I think what he rejoices about, is when a lost person becomes found. God gets excited when somebody who's disconnected from him becomes connected. God gets excited when somebody who's outside a relationship with Jesus Christ gets into a relationship with Jesus Christ. God gets excited when an outsider becomes an insider. And I believe the church that reflects the heart of God is the church that does the same thing. I believe the church that reflects the heart of God is the church that constantly seeks to save the lost. Those that help people find Jesus. Those that help people follow Jesus. Those that help lead people into a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. You want to know how valuable lost people are to God? Just look at what he was willing to sacrifice, and the answer becomes pretty clear, right? God was willing to sacrifice that thing that was most precious to him. God was willing to sacrifice his one and only son so that all people, no matter how insignificant they may be in their own eyes, no matter how small they may be in the world's eyes, he was willing to sacrifice that which was most precious to him so that all that were lost might be saved. And if God is willing to sacrifice his one and only son to save lost people, they must be incredibly important to him. And if God is willing to sacrifice what is so important to him, shouldn't we maybe get a little bit out of our comfort zone and spend a little bit of our time to do the same thing that God's passionate about? We have to ask ourselves, have we joined with Jesus to seek and save the lost? Or are we just gathering on Sunday morning, singing some songs, listening to some Bible verses, and then just going home and hoping everybody gets saved? I want you to try to imagine this scenario. Try to imagine this in your mind. If you have a child, and your child is lost, if you don't have a child, think about the person that you love most. And that person, that child, is lost. And they're lost in a forest. But there's a problem. They're lost, and they don't even know they're lost. They're on a path, and they hope at the end of this path that everything's going to be okay. But what you know and what they don't know, there's only one path in this forest that's going to lead to safety. Every other path is going to lead to death and destruction. And they aren't on the path that leads to life. They're lost, and they don't even know they're lost. And if you don't find them and get them on the right path, something tragic is going to happen to them. And there'll be nothing that you can do about it. So you gather a bunch of your friends and a bunch of people, and you tell them about your loved one, and you tell them about how they're lost, and if you need their help to help you find them before it's too late, and you're telling them if this person doesn't get found, if they remain lost, something horrible is going to happen, and there won't be anything I can do about it at that time. And the people that you gather together, they all know about this forest. They all know about these paths. They all know what terrible things are going to happen to them. That knew the danger, that knew this person was headed in the wrong direction, that was headed for death and destruction. And when they heard your story, instead of going out to look for your lost loved one, they just sat around and talked about it. They just talked about how terrible it was to be lost. They just sat around and sang songs about how horrible it was for people to be lost. They never went out and looked for your lost child, your lost loved one. They just sat around and talked about it. So I tell you what, you know, we're all so sorry that this is going to happen. Let's meet here next week and talk about it again. Talk about it some more. Instead of going out and looking for this person that you love so much, they began to sing songs again about how bad it was to be lost. They listened to somebody read from a manual about how to find lost people. But then they just go home and go back to their life like nothing was wrong. And your child is still out there and they're still lost and you're scared and you want them to be found. And they're acting like they don't even care. Maybe some of them during the week, they'll read the manual on how to find lost people. You know, they have their radio station set in their car. When they get in their car, they listen to the music about how terrible it is for all people to be lost and how we should go. They even sing along all during the week. But they never go out and look for this person that's lost. They never go out and look for your loved one, the person that you love so much. They just talk about it and sing about it. Wouldn't you be like, I don't care if you read the manual. I don't care. I don't even care if you look for them in the wrong way. Just get up and start looking. I need your help. I need you to find this person that I love before they get to the end of this path. And this path leads them to death and destruction. I need you to find my lost loved one before it's too late. Sometimes maybe that's how God feels about us. You know, we come to church every Sunday and we sing songs about the lost. We come to church every Sunday and we talk about finding the lost. We read the instruction manual, read the Bible, and it tells us that we should find the lost. But we never actually go out to seek and save the lost. We never go out to try to find lost people. That's why we're trying so hard here at the Odyssey Church to develop an environment culture where lost people can feel comfortable, where lost people want to come back. And we're hoping that one day we can make this so exciting. Not only do they want to come back, but they want to come back and bring a friend. Because this is what I believe in. This has got me in trouble in the past, but I really, truly believe this is what God has shown me. The church that God blesses isn't the church that makes it comfortable for church people. The church that God blesses isn't the church that makes it comfortable for the insiders. The church that God's blessing is the church which is passionate about what He's passionate about. He blesses the church that makes it comfortable for the outsiders to be comfortable. He blesses the church that when a lost person comes in, they can feel God's love through the love of the people that are here. He blesses the church that is concerned and is passionate about finding the lost. Sometimes I just thank God for letting me be part of this church. I'm so grateful for each one of you because you actually get this. A lot of churches don't get it. You actually get this. And And we don't want to be a church, and I don't think you want us to be a church where we just transfer the kingdom of God. You want to be a church that builds up the kingdom of God. We don't want to take flock from another church where they're getting fed. They're not getting fed. We welcome them here, but if they're getting fed where they're at, we're not interested in stealing sheep. We're interested in making sheep. We're interested in being a church that builds up the kingdom of God. And I know not everyone agrees with how we do church here. Be honest with me, sometimes I don't agree with how we do church here. I grew up in a very traditional church. But it's not about me. And you all get that. It's not about you. It's about God's children who He loves and are lost. It's about them, not about us. It's about bringing people into the kingdom of God. And I have to tell you, the results are speaking for themselves. We might do church a little differently than some churches. And if this church was about insiders instead of outsiders, we'd probably do church a little differently. But it's not. There's people here that were lost and that now are found. And you understand it's not about you. You understand it's not about the way we like to do church or the way you like to do it. It's about lost people. And we're passionate. We're passionate about lost people. We spend a lot of money to help seek and save the lost, to help people find and follow Jesus, to help lead them into a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. And you know what I pray? I pray no matter how big we become, and I have visions of us being very big, no matter how big we become, that we never, ever, ever get comfortable. That we never, ever get comfortable and just start talking about going out and finding the lost. Just sing about how terrible it is to be lost, but stop actually going out and finding the lost. You know, the bills are paid and the church is gone and we just sort of put it on cruise control. Enjoy the ride. I pray that day never comes. I pray that we stay passionate about what God is passionate about. And God is passionate about, Jesus is passionate about, finding the lost children. To helping those that are outside become inside. To those who are disconnected become connected. To those who are outside of a relationship, to be in a relationship with Him. Here's what we forget sometimes. These are our lost ones. People you love and the people I love who may be lost and they don't even know they're lost. They're just on a path which is going to lead to nothing but death and destruction unless they're found not spatially but relationally. Why is this so urgent? Why is now the time and why are we the people to do this? First of all, I believe our hearts should be passionate about what God's heart is passionate about. And God's heart's passionate about the lost. Second, Jesus commanded us to. It was His last instruction to us. After He died on the cross and was raised up from the dead and ascended back into heaven. Now I know if you're not quite sure Jesus is who He says He is, and you're not sure about the scriptures, that may all that sort of sound weird to you, but this is what I want you to know. There were over 500 people that witnessed Jesus Christ alive after He was dead. Now, you might think, oh, yeah, there's only two or three people. You can question that. But when 500 people record the same event, 500 people saw the same thing with their own eyes, that's hard to deny. You can pretty much count on that being a fact. Jesus commands the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28. It says, therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. But if neither one of those reasons, whether we should be passionate about what God is passionate about, if that's not good enough for you, if it's the fact that we are commanded to go out and seek lost people, mature and disciple, if that's not good enough for you, what about this one? Many of the people that you love, many of the people that I love, maybe people in your own family, I know there's people in my family, are on a dark, it's going to lead them to an eternal death. It's going to lead to destruction. And the fact is, most of them don't even know. They just hope when they get to the end of their life, everything's going to be okay. It's not going to be okay. If somebody doesn't show them the light of Jesus Christ, if somebody doesn't show them the light so they can get on the right path, which leads to life in abundance, they're going to stay on this path which leads to nothing but death and destruction. And if not you, if not me, then who? If you don't help them find and follow Jesus, they're going to stay in the darkness for all eternity. They're going to perish in a place Jesus described as complete separation from God, a place of eternal torment that's mentioned 162 times in the New Testament alone, and 70 of those times is attributed to Jesus Christ himself. So you can say there's no hell? Jesus said 70 times there's a hell, and there's going to be people that are going to end up there. In fact, he said the road to death and destruction is wide. The road to life and abundance is small. I'm going to share some facts with you. There's a group called Warner Group, and a lot of people believe that Warner Group is the leading research organization that focuses on the intersection of what we would call the world and the church, of faith and culture. They published an article in October 2014, so it's less than a year old right now. And in that article, the research shows 43% of all Americans are either unchurched or de-churched. 10% of Americans. 10%, one out of every 10, you walk down the street, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10. 10% of Americans never step foot in a church. They're completely unchurched. 33% were involved in church at one time, but are now de-churched. They are no longer involved in church. That means almost half the people in the United States are no longer going to church or attending church. And only 20% of the people, only 2 out of 10, attend church on any kind of regular basis at all. The number of churchless people in just 20 years, doesn't sound like a long time, but in just 20 years, the number of churchless people has gone up by 1/3. That's an amazing, scary statistic. But I tell you what's even scarier. 73%, almost 3 out of 4, have never been invited to church. Never been invited. Nobody's ever asked them to come to church. Now, we're a small group here, but I'm going to ask you, how many of you in here came to church because somebody invited you to church? Came to this church because somebody invited you? Somebody you knew or knew about our church, or maybe it was an invitation from me. How many of you came here because somebody invited you, sent you a card, email, or something like that? Almost all of them. One-to-one invitation is still the number one way people come to church. One-on-one invitation is the number one way people come to church. And you know what another scary statistic is? Only 2% of church people will ask somebody to church this year. Only 2 out of every 100 will ask somebody to come to church with them this year. Now, I know in this church, that's a lot higher, and I appreciate you guys for that. And you ladies as well. I'm sorry about the terminology. But for the last several weeks, we've been trying to encourage you, been asking you to invest in your friends, invest in your families, invest in your coworkers, invest in the people you see at the store, and invite them to come to church on September 20th. Now, why September 20th? Because we're having a barbecue. You don't have to invite them to come to church, just come out and invite them to a free meal. I mean, I know it can be uncomfortable inviting somebody to church, but how uncomfortable is it to invite somebody to come out and free food? And the response, I mean, if you don't believe that, you just ask me out to lunch and then tell me you're paying for it and see what happens. I'm telling you, it's a lot easier. And we're going to feed them physically, but you know what? We're going to feed them spiritually as well. That's only 2 weeks from today. So we're going to start ramping it up a little bit now. We're going to give you some tools to help you out and make it easier for you. Because even though we know we should step out of our comfort zone, even though we know we should have time and invest in people, it is hard to do. And I admit that even as a pastor, it's hard to do. So we're going to give you some tools this week and next week to help make it easy for you to invest and invite your lost friends to church on September 20th, which happens to be a national day. There's about 20,000 to 30,000 churches that are participating. About that, if you go to National or Back to Church Sunday, just backtochurchsunday.com, you'll see our churches listed in there. So we're sort of piggybacking that, and we're going to celebrate our 1 year anniversary that day as well. So I'm going to challenge you. There's prayer cards in your receipts and in your bulletins, and I would just ask you to pray about and ask God to let you come to mind five people who are not in church right now and write them on the back of this card. And begin praying about inviting them to church. Now you have this card, but you also have some postcards. I'm going to challenge you. The easiest way that I have found to do it, when I was in sales, I used to call it a warm call. A cold call was hard. If you didn't have a reason to call somebody, it was really tough. But send them a postcard. The five people you put on the back of this, send them a postcard, and then 2 or 3 days later, just call them up and say, hey, did you get that postcard from the Odyssey Church? And when they say yes, because you know they got to say yes because you sent it yourself, say, hey, would you like to come to church with me that day? I'll even pick you up if you want. Make it easy. And then take five more and just hand them out to people. Don't matter who they are, hand them out to the postcard. Anybody you think that's not in church, just give them a card and say, hey, would you mind coming out to our church? I'll meet you in a parking lot at 9:30. We meet for coffee and some donuts, and the service starts at 10, but we'll be there by 9:30 because we're going to have some good food at it. Because some people are out of church, they cook good food. 2 weeks. 2 weeks. It's easy. It's easy if you do it that way. Like 10 people. Now, there's about 20 of us here this week. There'll be, you know, we've been averaging about 30 people. So let's say next week we have 20 more. If everybody invites 10 people, that's 400 people that'll get 400 lost children of God that'll get an invitation to come to church on the 20th. I'm going to send out, because we have a large mailing list, I'm going to send out about 150 to 250 cards myself. And I'm going to call as many of those people as I can invite to church. So we're talking about 400 to 500 people that are going to get invited to come to church on the 20th. Now imagine, if just 10% of those, and these are friends and family, so you know really it should be higher, but let's just say 10% of them. That's 50 new people in this church, 50 lost souls, 50 lost children of God that will be here that day. And you know what the Bible says? That even if one of them is found, if just one of those people who are lost are found, Jesus Christ says, and yet this same account as recorded by the Gospel of Luke, recorded in Luke, he says, in the same way, there is more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 others who are righteous and haven't strayed away. You know what it doesn't say? It doesn't say if we gather around and we sing about the lost, if we read about the lost, if we hear about the lost, they'll be rejoicing in heaven. It doesn't say that. It says there's rejoicing in heaven when a lost sinner repents and returns to God. Because God's heart, His focus, His attention isn't on the insiders, but on the outsiders. God's attention is solely focused on the lost. And it should be our focus as well. If you've been found, if you're in a relationship with Jesus Christ and are no longer lost, you've been commissioned. Another word for commission is commanded or empowered. You've been commanded and empowered by Jesus Christ Himself to help people find and follow Him and to lead them into a deeper relationship with God. And our desire, our heart's desire is to be a church that continues to be a place where lost people feel safe, where lost people feel comfortable, where lost people feel loved, where lost people feel able to participate, because we've created an environment and a culture that lets them feel that way. Our passion should be for the lost, but not just on Sunday. We should be the church with the big C. We should be the body of Christ every day. We should be continually, like Jesus, seeking to save that which is lost. And that's why we're giving you these tools, to make it easy for you to invite people to church on September 20th. We're having a special event. We're having a barbecue. We've given you tools to help you identify the lost people that you love the most, and postcards to make it easy to invite them and others. If you need more, I want you to take more. They're out on the front counter. Grab them on your way out. Pick up as many as you think you'll send out. Jesus, the brother, James, the brother of Jesus, he says in the book of Acts, chapter 15, verse 19, he says, my judgment is that we should not make it difficult or the Gentiles who are turning to God? Who am I to argue with the brother of Jesus? If James said we should make it easy for those who are seeking God, for those that are lost, I think we ought to make it easy for those that are lost so that they can turn to God. You've been commissioned. You've been commanded. You've been empowered by Jesus Christ Himself to go out and find the lost children of God. So I'm challenging each one of you over the next 2 weeks just to invite a minimum of 10 unchurched or de-churched people to come here on the 20th in just 2 weeks for our one-year anniversary as we celebrate what God has done in us and through us. And as the pastor of the Odyssey Church, I'm going to do everything I can, I promise you this, to continue to make the experience and a culture and create, with the help of all of you, a place where lost people feel safe and comfortable and feel free to participate. But I need you to do what I can't do. I need you to do what I can't do without your help, and that's invite your family and your friends and your co-workers. I have a huge part to play in this. But I need you to do what I can't do to invite the people that you love that are far away from God, not spatially, but relationally. I need your help to seek and save the lost, because we're all that God has to do so here on earth. And He has empowered us, and He has commissioned us to do that. 2 weeks from now, I'm praying that our church is packed. I would ask you to pray with me over the next couple of weeks that lost people be found that day, and that the passion of this church remains for the lost. Now I'll get there. God, I come today and I am just so grateful, so thankful for the chance to invest in the lives of others. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to invest in the lives of the people that I love so that they may be found. Father, I thank you for the privilege, for the honor of being part of a church which allows me to be passionate about what you're passionate about. Father, help us lead your lost sheep. Help us to lead your children, the ones that you love, to your irresistible grace. Let us be a church that helps people find and follow Jesus. Help us be a church that helps lead people into a deeper relationship with you. And Father, we thank you for the opportunity to show your love and grant us the boldness. Give us the boldness so that we can make a difference in the lives of the people that you love. Help us to have the boldness to invite others to come to church with us so that they see what we have seen, a loving and merciful God, one who desires that all of his children be found. And I ask all of this in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I would ask again that we begin to pray for God to lead us to people, open our hearts and open their minds so that they can be bound, invite people to church. I'm going to ask you, we come back next week, and it's just so powerful that we can end this country. And this is what amazes me. In other countries, we don't have the freedom that we have in this country. And yet people are constantly going out to seek and save the lost, knowing that it may cost them their lives. And in this country, we have no dangers. We have a little bit of embarrassment in, and yet so many people don't do it. Next week, we're going to be talking about something that has the power to give life. We're going to be talking about something that has the power to give death. We're going to be talking about something that's corrupt. We're going to talk about something that's full of poison. So we're going to ask you to come back next week as we have a standalone message. And then the 20th, the week after that, we got some special performances next week too, so you might enjoy that as well. The message will be shorter next week too, so I know you'll love that. We'll still get out of here. And we got to ask the 20th, and then we start a new series on love. And I'm really, really looking forward to that. So thank you all for coming. Allow me to give the benediction, and then we'll go outside and eat some donuts. May the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you wherever you find yourself this week. Go into peace and the joy and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you all. Thank you.